And tonight, we're going to be in 2 Peter, 2 Peter chapter 1. Now, I just have four verses of scripture tonight, and this will be the second time in the last week that I've mentioned to you that not reading very many scriptures. I typically read 12 to 18 or so scripture verses, but tonight, just four verses of scripture. And I don't plan on holding you too long. I'm just going to share with you the burden of my heart. And I was thinking as I was just preparing this message, and I was thinking about what God laid on my heart. And I thought to myself, well, it probably won't be a very lengthy message. And I thought about what I tell my granddaughter, my grandson all the time, or at least two of them. I'll say, come over to Papa's and stay all night, and we'll sit up all night and watch Westerns. And, of course, we don't make it at about 10 o'clock. But my granddaughter always tells me, nope, she goes, no, Papa, I'm not watching any Westerns. And so, anyway, that's kind of the running joke in our home. But I won't keep you up all night, won't keep you busy all evening. So we'll get right into the Word of God. 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 1, and wherever you're at tonight, the staff that's here and at your homes and those that are in the parking lot this evening, let's stand together and we'll reverence God's very precious word. The Bible says, Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. According as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue. Now, I want you to notice verse 4. Whereby are given unto us great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Father, tonight, help us to preach, make the preaching easy, and we'll give thanks in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. You may be seated. I'm drawn tonight and hope to say a little something about this entire text, but I'm drawn to verse number 4, there where the Bible says that has given unto us exceeding great and precious promises. I've been praying for Liberty Baptist Church that God would send us a revival. I'm not talking necessarily about a series of meetings or even an announced meeting or a revival meeting. What I'm praying for is that God will send a spiritual awakening to the Liberty Baptist Church. A spiritual awakening. And I believe that such a revival in the hearts of the people of this church will start with a remnant. I mean a remnant of people that are willing to pray for such an awakening. And as we've been going through these unusual times and maybe have changed how we've been doing business and had to rethink how we hold church, and as we go through this these last few weeks, I believe that God has been teaching the church and our church some things, and he's been helping us and showing us the priorities of life. And so I believe as we consider over the last few weeks, I believe that we have come to realize the certainty of our faith. The certainty of our faith. I believe that also that God has demonstrated to us the urgency of this time. The urgency of this time. And also, I believe that God has helped us. He's helped this preacher. And I pray He's helped you to reach some conclusions to come to some conclusions regarding the church. And so tonight, may I just simply say that it's not so much about the program. It's not so much about the program as it is about the precepts or the principles of God's Word. And you might say, what are you saying, preacher? Well, to say it like this, we might say that as God deals with our hearts and we consider the certainty of our faith and the urgency of this time, and as we come to some conclusions, maybe we ought to put the emphasis. Maybe we should put the emphasis on the things that the Lord puts the emphasis on. Place our emphasis where the Lord places emphasis. I'm hoping and praying that in the weeks to come that God will help me to preach on the subject of revival, rebuilding and revival. Hey, when we come back to Liberty Baptist Church, I don't want to come back and just continue to do the same old things we've always done. I don't want to come back and just try to regain a status quo. I'm not hoping to come back and have just a little bit of what we used to have. Help, my friend, I want to experience a great spiritual revival. I want to rebuild, and I want us to come together and grow and prosper as a local New Testament assembly and be better than we've ever been, because we should not waste this time that God has given us to rethink and rebuild and seek revival in our lives. When we consider our text, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, we must consider the certainty of our faith. I thought about that. The certainty of our faith. And how could a preacher ever exhaust the certain truths and promises of God's Word? How can we ever get to the bottom of the certainty of our faith? Oh, listen, I mean, as I was making notes on this about the certainty of our faith, that portion of text there in verse 4, there that we read about great and precious promises, I'm glad tonight that we have some sure promises. We have some sure promises. I'm glad tonight we have a sure foundation. And I'm glad we've got a sure reward. And I'm glad we've got a sure anchor of the soul. And I'm glad that, my friend, we've got a sure acceptance, or we might say an assured acceptance in the Beloved. And I'm glad tonight that we can know and we can have with certainty know that God loves us, and He said He'd never leave us nor forsake us. The certainties of our faith. I was in a meeting earlier today, an online meeting with a ministry called Faith Twins, and talking about how we can increase Christian participation in our voting process, and how that 40 million Christians did not vote in the last election. And as I mentioned in that meeting, I made the statement, and I've made it here on many occasions. I hope by God's grace, as we consider the certainty of our faith, to plant our feet in some spiritual cement and make a decision that with the Lord's help, we will not be moved, that we'll keep our eyes on Calvary, and that we'll not back up and we'll not go to the left or to the right, but we'll keep marching forward for the glory of God. I want to consider the words of Solomon, or that's recorded, the words of Solomon in the book of Kings, in 1 Kings chapter 8. And Solomon's made this beautiful, wonderful prayer of dedication of the temple. And there in verse 56 of that 8th chapter, King Solomon has this to say. He says, "Blessed be the Lord that hath given rest unto his people Israel, according to all that he promised. There hath not failed." Well, glory. I mean, we ought to park right there for a minute. "There hath not failed one word of all his good promise, which he promised by the hand of Moses, his servant." I mean, God made some promises to Israel. The Old Testament saints of God, Israel. But my friend, God has left you and I with some promises. And he's given us some assurances and sureties and certainties of our faith in the New Testament. One writer said it like this. He said, "We're grounded in Christ, and it's of infinite value." My language is not sufficient to tell you of the great value of being a part of the body of Christ, that being saved by his marvelous grace, accepted into the beloved, forgiven of my sins, headed to heaven. Oh, listen, my friend. I see four things in our text tonight as we preach on this thought, the certainty of our faith. I'm preaching tonight to Liberty Baptist Church, and I want you to know tonight, there's some things that are certain. There's some things that are sure. There are some things that cannot be changed or altered. And my friend, I see, first of all, in verse 1, that we have a Savior who's worthy of total devotion. Our Lord is worthy of total devotion. I noticed there the apostle Peter writing, and it says, "Simon Peter, a servant." Simon Peter, a servant. Now, a lot of things can be said about a man, but the greatest thing that can ever be said about any man is that he's a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hey, listen, when Peter was saying a servant, an apostle of Jesus Christ, what he was saying was, "I've been purchased, I've been bought, I'm not my own, I'm his possession, I'm property of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's my Lord and he's my master." A servant. And every Christian has been purchased and possessed of the Lord Jesus Christ. You tonight that are under the sound of my voice, as I preach to Liberty Baptist Church about the certainty of our faith, the assurances and the sureness of what we believe, as I speak from God's Word tonight, may I say that you that are saved by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, you're a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ, and you're in good company. You realize that Moses was a servant of the Lord? Do you realize that Joshua, maybe the greatest, his final words that Joshua said, he said, "As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." I mean, Moses was a servant. Joshua was a servant. King David, who's mentioned over 1,000 times in the Bible, was considered the servant of the Lord. James there in the New Testament book that bears his name, is known as a servant. Jude, in the book of the scripture that bears his name, is known as the servant of the Lord. Hey, the prophets of God were known as servants. Amos records them as such in chapter 3 and verse 7. He said, surely the Lord God will do nothing, but he revealeth his secret unto his servants, the prophets. You're in good company, friend. You that are saved tonight, you that are servants of the Lord Jesus Christ, you're in good company. Hey, you're a part of the family of God. You're surrounded by a great host. I mean, Moses and Joshua and David and James and Jude and the prophets. And the Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 22 regarding Christians as a group. He said, for he that is called in the Lord being a servant is the Lord's free man. Likewise also, he that is called being free is Christ's servant. I've met a lot of good people. And oftentimes, one of the staff members that's here tonight is an inspector for a fire department. And we're practicing good social distancing. And we have nurses in the church. And I spoke to one this week by text. We have other people in the church, and they bear titles, and it's important. It denotes an achievement or profession in their life. And I say glory, hallelujah. I thank God for it. But my friend, hey, listen, oftentimes people will say, Pastor, when they see me, they'll say, Pastor, and they're addressing me by my title as pastor of the Liberty Baptist Church. But the greatest thing that could ever be said about me or any other man or woman is that we're the servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. Glory, hallelujah. The certainty of our faith. The certainty. I don't want to come back to church. And may I say, by the way, when we're able to meet again, and I'll be sending out a note, a private note to our church by the end of this week regarding this. But may I say, when we come back to church, we won't just flip the light on and everything will go back the way it's always been. It's not going to work that way. It's going to take weeks and months. There's going to be changes, and it won't all happen overnight. But my friend, I'm praying that God will send a spiritual awakening, that he'll open our eyes to the urgency of the matter, and that we'll conclude that there's some things in the church that are important and some things that are not. Pray that we don't waste this time that God has given us. I see in our text, I see that the Savior is worthy of total devotion. And I also see in that same verse that he's the Savior of faith. I'm preaching on the certainty. The certainty of our faith. He's the Savior of faith. Did you notice in verse 1, the Bible says, like precious faith. Like precious faith. Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious faith. Well, glory, there's two things that I notice about that faith. It's obtained, it's not earned. I mean, my friend, it's the gift of God. That faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And my friend, it's a precious faith. At the foot of the cross, the ground is level, my friend. Oh, listen, like precious faith. I mean, that same faith is same to the rich and to the poor, to the upper class and the lower class, to the well-fed and the hungry, to the religious man and the heathen, to male and female. It's like precious faith. I'm glad that when we gather here at church, and these altars are often filled, at Liberty Baptist Church on any given service. I'm glad that no matter what your circumstance is, that no matter where you come from or who you're related to or what you have done or have not done in life, I'm glad that at the feet of Jesus, at the foot of the cross, in the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the ground is level. The Bible says it's like precious faith. I see tonight the certainty of our faith. I see the Savior that's worthy of total, our Savior that's worthy of total devotion. I see tonight He's the Savior of faith. And then I see also He's the Savior of grace and peace. Did you notice in verse number 2? It starts with that statement. It says, grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. I thought about grace and peace. I thought about how that God has given me things that I did not deserve. And in His mercy, He's withheld from me the things that I did deserve. I'm glad tonight because I know Jesus. I know peace. And I'm glad that peace is a fruit of the Spirit. Hey, listen, may I say tonight that I, who once rejected God's word, am now accepted. I, who once ignored God's word, have now been called into the ministry. I, who once neglected the word of God, I'm now placed in His service. And I, who once was a sinner, have now been saved. I, who once was headed for hell, am now going to heaven. And I'm as sure as I'm already there. And as far as God's concerned, I've been made to sit in heavenly places. You say, what are you saying, friend? I'm saying that's grace. I've been saved by grace. He's the Savior that's due. He's the Savior of faith and the Savior of grace and peace. And my friend, I see then, not only that, but He's the Savior of the divine nature. The Savior of the divine nature. It comes there from verse 3 and verse 4. The Bible says, according as His divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of Him that called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Hey, listen, when I got saved, my friend, the certainty of our faith, when you got saved, at the moment you became a Christian, born again, you were indwelled with the Holy Spirit. I mean, He's the Savior of the divine nature. I mean, my friend, when you got saved, you got born again. I thought about the scripture in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse number 17. It said, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. You say, what happened? You became a new creature in Christ Jesus. God, you took upon the divine nature of God Himself. You were indwelled by the Holy Spirit. I mean, by God's grace, you're no longer the person you used to be. And as I preach to Liberty Baptist Church, and I challenge and encourage people to pray and to seek God in a spirit of revival, in a spiritual awakening, in this day in which we live. Oh, listen, may I remind you that you're no longer yourself. You're no longer, hey, listen, who you used to be. Now you're a new creature in Christ Jesus. The certainty of our faith. Trying to encourage you tonight to keep on and keeping on. Listen, the Lord's still on the throne. And the Lord's still in control. And He loves us. And He said He'd never leave us or forsake us.